us to get you all engaged in a conversation about how we can really incorporate this work and look at a public health lens to the transformation of juvenile justice systems.
And he has a program that helps reduce recidivism and is trying to attempt to help stop the children from going into prison. Lead by example approaches to grown men incarcerated or outside.
We trigger people's PTSD in prison by how they're treated by officers, how they treat each other, how the staff, and a lot of this injury that we're talking about is actually downstream effects.
This is really on the forefront of what our legislators are thinking about, and they're saying, College of Public Health, what are you doing about this?
They're pushing to see what can happen. So I don't know how UCLA thinks about the project that you mentioned. From UCLA campus, I think you're missing, there may be some opportunities from within these prisons to come up with some unique ideas.
Thank you for participating in your groups and for joining us back here now. So what we're going to do now is we're going to ask one of the leaders of each of the groups to come up and spend 2 to 3 minutes, and what we're really hoping for is your action items. This conference is about opportunities to action, so we'd like to hear what we as schools and programs of public health need to do. So in 2 to 3 minutes, hopefully you can give us that. Tomorrow, Amanda and I, with all of you, will have the last hour to really wrap up and have a plan going forward. And I just, again, want to say that, you know, we really hope that this will be a first of many times that we will all work together on these critically important issues. So I'm going to ask Amanda to come up, and she will call each of the people up to and do the presentation.
Okay, so I'm going to start by calling Max Kenner up from the Barred Prison Initiative to kind of report back the items from the prison education program.
So do you want to
just just have people come to the podium.
It's a good thing. So we had a great discussion. I think there are a few things that are really worth mentioning. We started kind of talking or reflecting on some of Brian's points this morning and talking about how, if we really want to address either problems in public health or in mass incarceration, what he described as proximity as being so important. And we talked about some of the pros and cons of that. And I think there's no question that schools of public health have a much, much larger role to play in answering the problems of mass incarceration. And we think that any way of measuring, any way of talking about these problems that's different than the way we currently do it, which is all about problems of criminality, right? Any evolution of that language can be great, and I think we agreed that public health would be a great one. But when we talk about how schools should engage, right? And Bob Fola talked about this, and you guys worry about hard-to-reach populations. We don't do that very much in college and prison business because everyone thinks our populations are hard to reach, but actually it's really very simple. But when you engage in this work, recognizing our people in prison, as an opportunity, as people that can learn and engage and access and research and convince and educate the public in a way that, frankly, and I know nothing about public health, so I feel comfortable saying this because it's true about educators in general, where in places where otherwise we fail is how we're going to make the best of this opportunity. And we have a real crisis, but it is an opportunity. But if we treat people in prison with real dignity and as students that have real capacity to learn, and all our experience says that they do, I think we'll see real great improvements in higher education and in public health, and maybe do something about mass incarceration. So those are our ideas, treating people in prison as students and as researchers and as people with real capacity, not as subjects. And I think if we do that, our subcommittee will have made a contribution. So thank you, everybody.
So I know that Commissioner Carrion had to leave, but if there is anybody who is in the Health and Juvenile Justice panel that could report back on some of the kind of most important take-home action items from that, we can have someone come up from there. Jeff, do you want to come up? Thank you.
Oh, sure. So hi, my name is Jeff Kutz. I am on the John Jay side of the Punishment to Public Health Initiative, so very excited to be here seeing this wonderful conference today. I think one of the main things that we talked about with Commissioner Carrion was opening lines of communication between academia and administrations, and so she recounted a couple of schools that had already approached her, but saying that all across New York City that there was two schools of social work, one that she had reached out to and one that reached out to her, and one school of public health, which I assume to be Columbia, that had reached out to her to this point in 5 months since she's been a commissioner, and that she was getting contact from a lot of other folks. And that led us into a discussion of how we as public health researchers could identify a research agenda that is not deficit-based. And identifying, and I think this goes back to earlier, the last panel discussion we had, where we can really identify ways to be resources for those that are trying to identify solutions. And so in the very first panel of the day, we heard from a district attorney who was saying, we don't really know how effective the ATI programs are in New York City. We know that some are good and some are bad, but we don't really have great data on the alternative to incarceration programs. And similarly, she was saying, Commissioner Carrion was saying, they are trying to figure out what are the best programs to put them in. And then also, almost as important as that, is how do you operationalize that? Once you decide what a great resource is that may work in another district, that may work in another setting with a different target population, how do you then sculpt that for your population and begin to operationalize it and replicate the things that work? So that was how we shaped our conversation. Is that accurate enough? Okay. Thanks.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Divine Pryor from the Center for New Leadership on Urban Solutions. Okay, here we go. So very quickly, my colleague and I co-facilitated a group, and I threw a model out that I knew was going to be controversial. So we talked about reentry, the rate in which people come out and go back, which in the United States has been about 70% for the last 40 years. Except I used the term social tuberculosis, and I exchanged the word reentry for reinfection. That individuals who are infected come in, they get cured, then they go back, they get reinfected, and this keeps happening. And I did that for a reason, because I wanted to give people an image of what was happening, that people are returning back to the same communities and they keep coming back to prison, and we need to start making the connection between the prison and the community if we're going to talk about reentry. So in that context, we collectively agreed that this was a multifaceted issue. So we talked about Help Homes, which is a research project right now in New York City that's focusing on individuals returning from home. We talked about developing a task force to go to HHS, but that it had to be comprehensive and every stakeholder had to be involved. I mean, there had to be lawyers, there had to be teachers, there had to be doctors and nurses, there need to be family members, there need to be corrections officials, law enforcement. Everyone had to be a part of this task force. That there needed to be a social movement to change the whole reentry narrative. Something that I wish that I had more time to expound on. There need to be a collaboration with law, school, and to create a class between constitutional law and public health, because there's such a close relationship between the two. We had to involve people, of course, who are previously incarcerated in the decision-making process, not just as window dressing, you know, or in a tokenized way, but in a real way. That we needed to mobilize around housing as prevention and healthcare, because after all, if a person doesn't have stability in their lives, you could give them all these other things that instability will make it very difficult for them to be successful. That we need deans and senior management have to meet with public health commissioners and state leaders to facilitate conversations, to identify issues and create policy solutions. We needed to define the problem of the failure of reentry as it currently is, and define what recidivism is so we can measure it, so we can measure it. That we need to get parole involved. We need to bridge a gap between health and recidivism and parole systems. And we need to integrate public health initiatives in parole organizations. And we have much, much more, but I'm going to stop there. Thank you so much for your time.
Hi, my name is Homer Venners. I am the Assistant Commissioner for Correctional Health for New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. So I oversee healthcare in the jail system. We focused on the health risks of incarceration. So what health risks do jail and prison confer to the people who pass through them, as opposed to always focusing on the health problems or personal characteristics of the people who pass through. And so in thinking through the ways in which jails and prisons directly harm people or create new risks of being harmed to people who pass through them, we thought about a couple of areas where public health schools and students and faculty can be particularly helpful. We talked a little bit about the breaking of the therapeutic alliance between health staff and their patients. In our setting, we talk about this in terms of a dual loyalty, which is a human rights concept that says that your mission to your patients is necessarily impacted. It's corroded because you're delivering health care in a jail or a prison. And that's dual loyalty. And that dual loyalty, we have lots of training we do, and we try and minister to the pressures that the correctional setting creates on it, our providers. But having students come in, public health students, medical students, psychology students, all those students coming in, help us keep a fresh eye on how bad dual loyalty gets, so that we, while we may train all the time, if we're stuck in the correctional setting for days or weeks or years doing the same thing over and over, it's only sometimes when a student walks in and says, I can't believe that you have this policy towards these people, or I can't believe that this important information about their healthcare goes this other way that doesn't help them. So that is one area where the participation of students and faculty is important. The other is we talked about kind of a mode of technical assistance. So we spent a little bit of time talking about it, you know, some really disturbing stories from one setting where pregnant women in a state prison system, just at the moment where they're about to give birth, are furloughed, basically dumped out on the streets so that they can go deliver babies so that it's not a cost to the correctional setting. The local, you know, safety net hospitals soak up this cost, and then they come back into the prison system. So that's obviously a disturbing practice. We talked about how, and this was in Minnesota, and so we talked about how can we provide technical assistance to people who have stories like this. And so part of that technical assistance is using our public health knowledge to find these cases, to aggregate them, to do an analysis. Part of it is to link up with litigators, people that ultimately, you know, the reason that people in jail and prison have health care guaranteed to them is Estelle v. Gamble. But part of it also is, and this is increasingly, I think, important, is for us to think about how this relates to the ACA and health plans. Because those safety net hospitals, all those people that take care of patients who have worse outcomes, the people who feel the health risks of incarceration, somebody pays for the care, ultimately. If you come in and your mental health, you have a global assessment of functioning of 70, and you leave and you have a gaffe of 30, guess what? Somebody's going to pick up the pieces, because everybody pretty much leaves jail or prison. So who's on the other end? Who's the health plan? Who's the health home? Who's the paying entity? Because ultimately, the litigation strategies can be successful, but we also need to think about our partnership, public health schools, partnerships with health plans and large health systems to bring pressure to bear on correctional settings to deliver higher quality care. Thanks.
My name is George Sagai. I'm at the University of Connecticut, and I'm in the School of Education, so I'm sort of an outlier here in some sense. I was asked to be the summarizer because I don't know what you guys do. Our task was to look at the school-to-prison pipeline, and it was quite fascinating. We had about an hour to talk about something we wanted to have our own session about. The main focus of our session was about prevention, especially thinking about early stages of the life course that was mentioned earlier this morning. We decided that we wanted to focus on schools, but our conversation included issues around families, around child abuse, around foster care, around school resource officers, so we expanded beyond the walls of the school. We came up with five recommendations that we want you to consider as you think about actionable steps. We did it in the context of thinking about, in the room, we have researchers, we have administrators, we have policy decision makers, we also have personnel preparation folks, as well as direct service providers in the room. So we wanted to generate these five actionable steps in at least a manner that would allow everybody to identify with. First one is we need to think about enhancing our focus on public health in a more systemic manner, meaning that it's not just about the kid or the adult, it's also about the family, it's also about the neighborhood, it's also about the extended family, it's also about the peers and support systems. We think that there's an endemic problem and not just a generic one. Second recommendation is looking at research. We thought that we have a toolkit, but the toolkit has some rusty tools in it, or tools that we're not quite sure how to handle. And we thought that it was very important for us in the public health world to redefine our research base and our evidence base such that we have strong basic research that allows us to move into applied research, that also allows us to accommodate the different cultural and contextual variables for which our tools have to be applied. We also talked about the importance of replication across a variety of settings, and we talked about the importance of making sure that we have an evidence base that we feel like we can defend as we go about doing this work. The fourth recommendation was to pay attention to the implementation science, meaning that we can create this set of tools, but if we don't implement or create environments that allow the implementation to be done with high levels of fidelity or to be able to be adapted to local context, we're going to be in trouble with producing the outcomes that evidence base might promise. Fourth, we said that it was really important that we think about collaborative partnerships in the implementation of our public health agenda, meaning that, and specifically in the sense of personnel preparation, what we find is that the public health domain is not necessarily expanding out and affecting other places where personnel preparation occurs, like in teachers at schools of education, like where I live, or in social work, or in school psychology, or in counseling, where there are partnerships that might allow us to be more effective in approaching some of these challenges. And the last one, which was kind of an umbrella for all four of those, is that we really got to pay attention to local context and culture for which research, implementation science, collaborative preparation, and systems are being implemented. We know that what happens in Iowa is going to be a little different in Connecticut. We know what happens in Storrs, Connecticut is going to look different than what happens in Bridgeport. And we know that we've got to consider those local variables as being important to the implementation. So those are the five things that we said people should pay attention to. Monica was my partner. Did I forget anything, Monica?
Communicating our messages better. We have to have partnerships so we can communicate our messages.
Yeah, we need to talk to others in a more systematic way. We had a journalist in the room who was saying, you know, how important it is to think about how our message is communicated and branded. Thanks.
So we, I'm Jody Rich from Brown. We had a lively discussion and we had a strong sense that this drug and alcohol and mental health epidemic of incarceration is happening on our watch, that this is our responsibility and we need to do something about it. We can't pass this on to the next generation. At the same time, we really felt we need to involve and engage the students in as aggressively as we can. So we think there, and I'm influenced by Brown having just gone through an accreditation process. We talked about the Framing the Future document that Bob Meenan from BU has been involved in and want to explore whether there's a possibility to make some kind of accreditation requirement having a correctional angle, and I think Bob has some good ideas about that, and we can work through that. And there's a question whether to focus on have a few schools of public health involved or have it diffusely across all the schools of public health, but some required coursework or some required expertise or something, maybe offer concentrations, something like that. We talked about the role of the trade association, I guess ASPPH. Could they come out with a statement, or could the members of, you know, in this room of schools of public health come out with some kind of a statement saying this is a huge public health problem and that we need to pay attention to that? The voice from public health has not been heard yet on this as loudly as it could be. And that we should perhaps do that. David?
Sure.
So one of the overarching substantive topics that we talked about was the fundamental need for, when it comes to addressing the fact that jails and prisons have become de facto treatment institutions for so many people. We can think across the entire criminal justice spectrum, but for public health schools, public health professionals, perhaps we should be putting the impetus back on that front end prevention piece. And what that might look like is revisiting a mission that came up in the 1960s, came back in the 1980s, and that's rebuilding the conception of what is effective community behavioral health for substance use treatment, for mental health treatment, and to build the infrastructure, the clinical services, the service models that give us more placement to put people who might come into contact with the justice system to avoid arrest, but also just to prevent them from ending up there in the first place. So building, you know, just greater curriculum, coursework on mental health and policy, on history, on service models, I think is something that I would, you know, definitely like to see in more public health schools. And then related to that, touching on what Homer mentioned, was the importance of the Affordable Care Act, its ability to get us to rethink these capacity questions through Medicaid expansions, through new service models like health homes. We have a really important, ripe opportunity to rethink how we build connectivity between justice systems, but even a step further from that, just bolstering what community health really even is. And then, did you get to the messaging point?
No.
Okay, so messaging. We thought just overall it would be really effective to have this issue be something that public health deans and leaders talk about, like obesity, like smoking, and just have this consensus where we all sign on and we all say this is one of the most pressing public health crises facing us. And we think that, you know, all the states and jurisdictions in the room, the schools, the influence can be really effective in terms of just reaching the students, reaching the media. So that could be a, you know, maybe an obvious first step. Thanks.
The New York statement.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. So thank you, and we'll adjourn until next door to continue the discussion.